We'll never know how life started on Earth. We'll never know how life starts anywhere else. But what we can do is understand how it could have happened. We can understand each step as a coherent step. And that's really what we want to know. Intellectually, can we understand how a sterile, non-living planet can give rise to a planet full of life, full of cells? Life started very early, 4 billion years ago, give or take. And then it got stuck in a rut at the level of bacteria. So very small, very simple cells. And then on one occasion in this 4 billion years, this complex cell type arose, cells with a nucleus. Every cell in our body has the genes, has DNA inside the nucleus. And we all have all these traits in common. So mushrooms and humans, we all have this nucleus. The traditional way of understanding evolution over the last 20 or 30 years has been just to sequence genes and to compare them and to reconstruct a great tree of life, how closely related different organisms are depending on their genes and the information that we can read from their genes. And what they show is that all complex cells are actually chimeric. We have two parts to us, and one part is bacterial. The other part actually is a bit more mysterious. They're called archaea. And for a long time we knew about them because we find them in hydrothermal vents and we find them in extreme conditions. A lot of them are extremophiles. And it seems that all complex cells derive from a chimera, between some kind of genomic chimera between bacteria and archaea. Now, what we can't agree about is why that would make a difference. And a perspective which has been overlooked, in my view, is what the bacteria brought to the table. What they brought to the table was energy. They are now our mitochondria. They produce all the energy that we need to live, but actually they produce all the energy required for all complex cells. By internalizing bacteria, which become our mitochondria, that allows cells to become enormously larger and more complex. That overcame the constraint that bacteria have. So if we think about evolution from the point of view of energy, we can begin to understand why it is that life has had this very peculiar history. All cells have a very peculiar way of going about generating energy. It's not at all what anyone would predict. What you would expect would be it's just chemistry. But actually, it's not like that at all. In fact, life is basically electrical. We have a charge across the membrane in our own mitochondria, but bacteria have it around the cell. It's an amazingly strong charge. It's about 30 million volts per meter, which is the same as a bolt of lightning. So we have a charge equivalent to a bolt of lightning across this very, very thin membrane. And that's how all life is operating. What complex life has, by internalizing these bacteria, which become our own power packs, they lose all the superfluous stuff that they don't need as bacteria anymore. And they specialize for energy generation, and that allowed our genomes to swell up and become enormous. The human genome is 90% junk, but it's the raw material to do things. So junk is not garbage. Junk is what you keep in the garage for a rainy day, and that's what cells do, effectively. We have the power to keep these large genomes and eventually use them for things, to become a human, whatever it might be. One aspect that we are testing in the lab, essentially, all life, in one way or another, uses carbon dioxide and hydrogen. The way it all probably began is just taking hydrogen as it bubbles out of the ground in hydrothermal vents. The problem is that hydrogen and CO2 do not react very readily. But when they do react, it actually releases enough energy to drive further reactions. So if you can make them react, then everything gets going. What makes them react? Well, in cells, what makes them react is the electrical charge across the membrane. And one of the very nice things about a particular type of hydrothermal vent is that they have a very similar charge across thin inorganic barriers. And that, we believe, should drive the reaction of carbon dioxide and hydrogen to make organics. It also provides a way of concentrating organics within a system and really driving the parts of a cell to form up and become a protocell, if you like. So we're trying to test in the lab, can we drive that reaction and make organics? And the answer is yes, we can, to a degree. And yes, this charge makes all the difference. I'd like to think that we are recapitulating the origins of life, because what we're doing is we're using life itself, cells themselves that we still find in these environments, as our guide to the kind of chemistry, the kind of ways that they make hydrogen and carbon dioxide react together, the way that they produce all the organics they need to grow from that. we think that all of these reactions should happen in this environment in the absence of the enzymes that make it happen today in these cells. So we're using life as a guide, and we're seeing how much can we recapitulate of what cells do in the absence of organic molecules. How much can we use the environment to drive the same reactions? Genes and comparing gene sequences, this enormous amount of information has dominated biology and our perspective on evolution over the last 50, 60 years. But what we've been missing is energy, the fact that cells are living, they are alive, and this provides constraints, and those constraints have actually affected the whole trajectory of evolution. And one big interesting question is, was that inevitable that life went down this pathway? Does energy necessarily constrain genomes in this way? Would it happen the same on another planet? Or is it chance that it happened that way on Earth?